Hi, this is Paul Morin with the Energy Conservatory, and welcome to the first part of our two-part series on commercial building blow door testing. We'll cover a few housekeeping items first. If you're having trouble with the audio, click on Meeting in the main navigation menu and choose Audio Setup Wizard and go through those steps, and that should get your audio up and running. If you have any questions as we go along, please type in responses. We will be answering some of the questions as we go along, and then we'll have a question and answer section at the end also. The webinar is being recorded, and it'll be on our YouTube channel soon, along with our other webinars and other training videos and some other humorous videos that are on our YouTube channel, so check that out. And please let us know the type of webinars you'd like to see in the future. We have found that recommendations we get from our listeners are the ones that are the most popular. So we're always looking for input from you on what type of webinars you'd like to see in the future. If you're looking for BPI continuing education units, this webinar is available for one continuing ed unit, and it's typically one CEU per hour, and we'll upload that data to BPI, and it goes through the normal process that BPI goes through, so you're probably familiar with that. You won't receive a completion certificate, and you don't need one of those. But certainly check your on the BPI site in a month or so and make sure that you've gotten credit for the webinar. If you haven't provided us with your BPI number yet, you can send an email to editor@energyconservatory.com and include your full name, company, and BPI number, and we'll make sure that that you get those continuing ed units. You will need to be logged into the same email address used when you registered in order to get credit. So if you're sitting at a computer with somebody else who's logged in, you won't get credit for it. You need to be logged in using the same email address that you used when you registered. This webinar and the next one in the series is based on and follows along the same structure is our blow door applications guide beyond single family residential manual, and that manual came out in spring of 2014, and it was put together by Terry Brennan and Mike Clarkin of Cameraden Associates, and Gary Nelson, Colin Olson, and myself of the Energy Conservatory. And it's a pretty comprehensive manual, and you can download that from our website for free. And it'll go into more detailed information than what I'm covering today. And really, there's no need to take notes today because all the information will be in that applications guide. So what we're going to cover today is chapters 1 and 2 of that manual. And chapter 1 is what does a blow door tell us? And chapter 2 is planning a blow door test. So the information we'll be covering today is some of the basic building science of air tightness testing, and it's important. We're gonna go into some detail, and it's important to understand this when you're these details when you're doing big building testing, and then also planning the blow door test. And the second part of the series will cover chapter 3, preparing the building. So that's once you're at the building, your planning is all done and it's test day, preparing the building and setting up and performing the test. So that'll be covered in the next session. There are two other chapters, finding the air leaks and writing a report, but we're not going to cover those two chapters in our webinars. So tune in to our book, and you can find out more information about finding air leaks and writing a report. So we're going to start out with just the basics. So this is a real simplified version of what a blower dart test is. The mass of airflow in needs to equal the mass of airflow out in a building. So the basics of a blower dart test is we induce a pressure. We change the pressure in the building by X amount, and then we measure the airflow blowing through the fan. So we know an equal amount of air leaks in, equal mass of air leaks in. So we can figure out how tight or leaky a building is that way. We need to set the building up in single zone conditions typically. That's not always possible, but in commercial building testing, we can get into more complicated configurations, and we'll be talking about that a little bit. But if you want to be able to ideally test in single zone conditions, and in the stand, and typically commercial buildings are tested at 75 pascals instead of 50. That's pretty widespread that is the new standard for testing larger commercial buildings. And in order to set up single zone conditions, you'll want to make sure bottleneck locations are within 10% of each other. So you'll measure interior pressures and make sure there's not more of a 10% spread between those far reaches of the building or bottlenecked areas of the building. So that would be at 75 pascals. You want all the pressures in the building to be within 75% of each other. So this is an example of a test, and I'm going to be using this is as an example throughout the webinar. This is we did some repeatability testing on an 11-story building, and we set up all of the blower doors on the main level of the building. They were about a floor apart, half a floor, I guess. There was a half a flight down in a stairwell. We had two blower doors set up in that location, the other two right in the front, main level of the building in the front. So, and what we're seeing here is we've got an 11-story building, and it's about 30-35 degrees outside. So at the bottom of the building, we're seeing 95 pascals down here. It's kind of hard to read these numbers, but this point is 90 and this point is 100. So we're 95 pascals. We had a baseline of 20 pascals, about 20. So we've got an induced pressure of 75. Our baseline was 20, negative 20. So we're down about 95 pascals for our first data point. And this yellow line up here, this is a zero line, dotted line just below the yellow line here. This is the top of the building with respect to the main level of the building. And we can see, this is five, positive five, this is zero, this is the top level of the building with respect to the main level. And we're at about 4 pascals. So we're less than a 5% difference from the top floor of the building down to the main level of the building in this case. So that is 4.5 pascals compared to 75. It could be as much as 7.5. We're at 4.5. So we're in what is considered single zone conditions. We had three stairwells. We were able to block all the doors open, and that was enough interconnection to achieve single zone conditions, even though all the blower doors were way down on the lower level. So one way of determining if you have, or helping you figure out if you do have single zone conditions, is you can use the orifice flow equation. And that is CFM equal 1.07 times the area of a hole in square inches times the pressure across the hole. So, you know, technically it should be a sharp-sided orifice, which refers to a thin piece of material with a uniform hole, you know, something, you know, square or round. And there are other parameters of that too, but this works to give you an approximation of if you're going to have single zone or bottleneck condition. So in the example we're using at the bottom here, 10% at 25 Pascal is 2.5. So when we're taking data point at kind of the low end of our spectrum at 25 Pascals, we're going to determine how much airflow. We've got an area that where there's kind of a bottleneck, and we've only got one door opening to connect that with the main body of the building. So the door is 7 feet by 3 feet, so we calculate square inches of that. So we're going to put this into that formula. 25 Pascals across this door, is that going to be a problem where we're more than 10%? So we're using 1.07 times the area of that door opening times 10% of our induced pressure, 2.5. We'll take square root of 2.5. And when we run those numbers through, we get a little over 5,000 CFM. So, you know, as a rule of thumb, we can think about a 3-foot by 7-foot door opening as about one blower door's worth of air, generally speaking. So, you know, if we've got a wing of the building that only has one door opening to it, if we think we're going to get more than one blower door's worth of air through that, then we'll have a problem and we'll need to set up a door in that area. So that gives you a little bit of guidance on determining ahead of time in the planning stage if you're going to need an extra blower door out in that area. A single fan, so bringing a single fan shroud so you can set up one fan in that area, for example. Stack effect, you know, we talked about a 20 Pascal baseline in that area. So stack effect definitely it will play a role in figuring out what your target pressures are. You know, when you think you just needed to get it to 75, but at 75 Pascals, in this case, we'd only be inducing a 55 Pascal pressure change with the blower door. So we've got a formula here for how to calculate stack effect. We've got a 70 degrees inside and 20 degrees outside. Stack effect is measured in this formula from the neutral pressure plane of the building, which we don't know where it's going to be, but we're assuming it's in the middle, and two-story building, so we've got 8 feet per floor, 50 degree temperature difference. We run that through, so at the top or the bottom of the building in this case, we'd have 2.7 Pascals. 50 degree temperature difference, two-story house, we're measuring at the very bottom of the building or at the very top of the building. So that kind of gives you a sense of scale there. Taller buildings, we're going to have a much higher, you know, same pressure difference, 70 degrees, 20 degrees. But now we've got 55 feet from the neutral pressure plane. Now we're at 18 Pascals, assuming the neutral pressure plane is in the middle. So, you know, stack effect is a function of the pressure difference and the height from the neutral pressure plane. So the taller the building and the colder it is or warmer it is outside, the bigger pressures we're going to have. Another thing that's important to know is when flow is added or removed from a single zone pressure, The pressure in the building changes by exactly the same amount everywhere. So if we have true single zone conditions, we have a big warehouse building, it's all open, and we're removing or adding flow to that, everywhere in the building changes by exactly the same amount. So that's an important principle to know. So in this case, we're seeing negative 5 at the bottom and positive 5 at the top of the building. Again, we've got the neutral pressure plane in the center, exact center of the building, so our pressures at top and bottom are exactly the same. And if we want to induce a 50 Pascal difference, now if we measure the pressure at the bottom, we're at negative 55. If we measure, because we've moved from negative 5 to negative 55, so we're going to be reading negative 55 at the bottom, and we've moved 50 Pascals at the top, and we're at negative 45 at the top. So this is same example I used on a previous slide, but this is a baseline period of record. It's not the the 75 induced. This is a pretest baseline reading, and we're measuring 4 pressures, one on each side of the building at the bottom of the building, and 4 pressures, one on each side of the building on the top of the building. So we're seeing, you know, pressures at the top at somewhere around plus 5, 4.5, 5, and at the bottom we're seeing, you know, 2 distinct lines there, because so now I put an image of the building in the middle of here. We can think of this, if the pressures are equally distributed across the building, this is a long skinny building with a long side going down a fairly steep hill. So the lowest level coming out on the lake side is about 3 stories lower than 2.5, 3 stories lower than the main entrance up on the front of the building. And we've got 2 tubes going out on that level and 2 tubes going out at the bottom level. And then the other are at the top. One thing we can see here is our neutral pressure plane, where the pressure is 0, is way up towards the top of the building. Most of the leaks of this building are at the top. So our neutral pressure plane is very high. And we're measuring, you know, somewhere around 20 Pascals at the bottom and 4 Pascals at the top. If we moved that neutral pressure plane down to the middle, we'd be more around, you know, 13 or 14 Pascals at the bottom, 13 or 14 at the top. But because our neutral pressure plane is so high, we've got much higher pressures at the bottom and lower pressures at the top. And in order to measure these pressures, we need to stick the tube out at that location. So one way to think about this is, what's causing these pressures, what's causing the stack effect pressures is the weight of air at that given temperature. Air is denser and heavier at lower temperatures, and standard barometric pressure is about 100,000 Pascals, which is about 3 Pascals per foot. So that's a lot of, you know, the weight of the air is a lot of weight pushing down. And we can think about, you know, it's cold outside and warm inside. The weight of the air outside is heavier. That's pushing down, and that's pushing air into the bottom of the building. And air out needs to equal air in. So air is leaking out of the top part of the building and in at the bottom. if we took a tube and ran it from the top floor to the bottom floor inside the building, we would measure zero pressure because the weight of the air in that tube is the same as the weight of the air around it, so that tube might as well be invisible. We wouldn't see a pressure if we're measuring from the top to the bottom of the building, assuming that the top and the bottom are, and the space in between is at the same temperature, because the weight of the air in the tube is going to be the same as the weight of the air outside the tube. So that's important to understand. So if we measured, you know, pressure, we ran the tube outside and thought, well, I want to see what the pressure is at the top, and we just had a long tube and brought that gauge up to the top, we would still be reading the pressure at the bottom, because no matter where we go with that gauge in the building, if the tube is exiting the building at the bottom, we're going to read the same pressure. So if we want to find the neutral pressure plane, we need to stick the tube out at that location and measure the pressure there. So those are important things to understand about, you know, getting single zone conditions and trying to understand pressures in a building. Wind effect. So we talked about stack effect. Wind effect is another thing that is going to affect pressures, what pressures we're seeing in a building. So we can see, you know, the wind is coming from one direction and blowing over a roof and creating some crazy pressures near the building. If we're only measuring one outdoor reference, it's best to do that on the leeward side of the building towards the center of the building, because you kind of have a zone there where there's the least amount of fluctuation of anywhere else. So if we're only measuring one pressure, that's our best location, right up next to the building, towards the center of the building on the leeward side. And this picture came from some research done by CMHC and is in the Canadian Building Digest. So wind pressure, you know, that it's definitely a major force for air leakage on tall buildings. We see, you know, much higher wind pressures in tall buildings, as you can imagine. Wind pressure is a function of wind speed squared. So as we start increasing wind speed, our pressures go up dramatically. Fluctuating wind is going to be more troublesome than a steady state wind. You know, a steady state, we're not going to see a lot of fluctuation. But when we have gusting winds, we're going to see some pretty crazy pressure differences on big buildings. You know, as much as 40, 50 pascals from one side of a building to another. Measuring pressures on four sides of a building and averaging them is commonplace in commercial buildings. That's kind of the standard methodology on what you should be doing. And here's an example of that. Again, so this is a baseline period of record from that previous test that we showed. And you can see, you know, to get an idea of what the scale is here, we've got negative 23 at the bottom, negative 15, you know, negative 14 at the top here. So we've got a range, negative 14 to negative 23. And if you were using any one of those pressures, you see fluctuations of more than 3 pascals over that period of record. But when you average all four of those, there's fluctuations of less than plus or minus a half a pascal. So it really does calm down the effect of wind when you're averaging pressures on four sides of the building. And then we've got the mechanical effect on buildings. And this is huge also. when I was working for the Center for Energy and Environment, they were doing some testing on some bigger buildings and measuring there was issues with skyways between buildings being at dramatically different pressures and lots of airflow going from one building to another. And rather than using blower doors to create a pressure, we asked the mechanical contractor in one of the buildings if he could use the mechanical systems in the buildings to apply a pressure. And he was able to easily apply a 30 Pascal pressure difference between inside and outside using the mechanical fans in the building. So the mechanical either exhaust or supply can have a huge effect on buildings. So operating fans and chimneys definitely will affect your baseline and your pressures in the building. So you need to make sure that all fans and combustion appliances are off during the test. So this is going to require getting some mechanical people out there who understand the building to make sure everything is turned off. And even you'll find when they think everything is turned off, you'll get up on the roof and there's still some exhaust, some package rooftop units that are still on. And luckily you're able to take off the hood and typically turn those off from up on the roof. But even when the contractors think they're all off, that doesn't necessarily mean they're all off. And depending on the purposes of the test, you know, one thing that's a lot different as you go from single family detached residential to commercial buildings is the amount of exhaust and outdoor air inlets. Oftentimes the size of an overhead garage door. And so those are intentional openings in the building. And you want to make sure dampers are closed or even temporarily sealed to make them airtight. So that's an important aspect of testing commercial buildings also. And you can be spending more time doing the sealing of mechanicals than you are setting up and performing the blower door test. So now let's assume we have a building perfectly airtight. To pressurize by 50 pascals, in order to change the pressure in the building, you need to compress the air in the building. And it'll take a little while. If you've got a big volume building, it'll take a while to get to that pressure. So if you've got a very large building that's very tight, it's going to take some time to get that building to a pressure and to get it to stabilize. So you have to understand that and adjust the pressure in the building slowly and wait for it to equalize. And most of the time, rather than setting the cruise function of the software, you'll need to manually ramp up the fan and then wait for it to stabilize and then ramp it up a little more and wait for it to stabilize. So it becomes, it's an interesting problem that we've gotten calls on quite a few times when you're starting to test large volume buildings with that are very airtight. We've seen pictures of tests done in Germany where we've got a 8 or 10 story building and they're using one blower door to do the test because of how tight it is. You start to run into kind of unique things in how you perform the test. Tubes versus cables. Generally speaking, you want to use short tubes and long cables. There are a number of reasons for that. Stepping on tubes, you get pressure spikes, and the more tubes you have running around, the more likely that's going to be problematic. Tubes of longer than 100 feet cause measurement errors, so try to keep all your tubing length. Sometimes that's not possible when you're measuring, from the top floor to the bottom floor of a building. But for the most part, you know that you will be able to get by with less than 100 feet, and we don't recommend going over 100 feet because that's going to introduce some errors. Tubing of a smaller diameter than what we use can cause larger measurement errors. So if you're measuring more than 100 feet with smaller tubing, that introduces additional error. And sun shining on longer lengths of tubing will cause errors, as will anything else that causes change in temperature of the tubing. So keep that in mind. If there's temperature change somewhere along that length of the tubing caused by the sun or something else, that can cause fluctuations also. So for running tubing through a vertical space that's at a different pressure, and then so if we're trying to run a tubing a good example is you have a tall building and you don't have a good way to run the tube down, so you run it outside and then back inside the building again, that tubing is going to be at a different temperature when it's outside. So you're going to get some fluctuation in pressures in that tubing caused by that temperature difference. So so it's not advisable to run the tubing through a space that's at a different temperature. You'll see some of those fluctuations. So generally speaking, again, wherever you can, use short tubes and long cables. An example of that, I was out on a test where we had about 150 feet of black tubing. You know, dark color tubing is going to be affected by the sun more than lighter color tubing is. We had about 150 feet running, sitting in the sun, and we were getting that one channel is getting lots of fluctuations compared to the other channels, and there was hardly any wind at all. So we knew something else is going on. And that the end of that tube ended up being about 6 feet from a door opening. So we just ran one extra gauge to that location and ran along 150 feet of cable instead of 150 feet of tube, and that solved that problem. So keep that in mind. During a blower dart test, measurements are made. We're looking at the we need to take a number of different measurements. One is going to be the pressure difference between inside and outside. We're measuring a pressure at the flow sensor of the fan. Remember that the gauge isn't directly measuring flow, it's measuring pressure, channel A and channel B. They're both measuring pressure, and channel B is converting pressure to flow, or the software, you have it set to be a Model 3 blower dart fan, and that's making a conversion from the pressure at the flow sensor of the fan to flow. So that's another pressure we need to measure. We need to monitor pressures between the building core and interior locations to make sure we have single zone conditions. So in TechLog, we'll be calling pressures between inside and outside envelope pressures. We'll be calling pressures that are measuring flow. We'll be calling those a flow pressure. And we're going to call the pressures that we're monitoring, the building core to other interior pressures, we're going to call interior pressures. And then we also have a generic pressure if you're just monitoring some pressures, maybe a zone that's partially outside. You want to make sure that zone is outside during the test, but you're not looking to include that in an Army Corps report where it's going to display all the everything you've got labeled as interior pressure and compare that with the with the induced pressure of the building to make sure you're in single zone condition. So you'll want to label any interior pressure as an interior pressure for that reason. We're going to want to monitor interior and exterior temperature differences before and after the test, because the software is going to ask for those. The elevation above sea level, we're going to want to know that, and we make a density correction based on the temperature difference between indoor and outdoor temperature and the elevation. We have to make a density correction to the flows that the software is reading. And test results have historically been reported in units of airflow and induced pressure differences. And the most common ones are the results will be reported in CFM 50 or air changes per hour at 50 or CFM per square foot of floor area. Or it could be at a different pressure. It could, you know, the pressure might be 75 pascals. But typically, you know, we're reporting it in either CFM 50 or air changes per hour or CFM at 50 per square foot of floor area or surface area. More commonly, envelope area. So there are two basic test methods that are called out for, or there's a lot of other protocols also that refer to these two basic test methods. Multipoint regression is ASTM E779, and it does regression analysis using the formula for flow, where the flow equal a flow coefficient times the change in pressure raised to the n flow, the flow exponent. So we end up with, so this is a linear scale where everything, the airflow is evenly spaced and the pressures are evenly spaced on the scale. We'll see kind of this half U curve as pressures get as pressures get higher as we go along this scale, the amount of airflow gets less and less as we go up. So you need to keep that in mind. We can see on this scale, if it takes three fans to get to 25 pascals, it's going to take less than three to get to 50. So in this case, at 25 pascals, so if we go out here to, this is 30, 25, we're up at about 1700. But at 50 pascals, so it takes four fans to get to 25, but to get to 50 pascals, we're at about 26,000. So it only takes two additional fans. It takes four to get to 25, but it only takes two additional to get to 50. So if we're doing, we wanna do a pretest, so the building is pretty much done, and they'll allow us, conditions allow us to go in and do a pretest ahead of time, and we're estimating that we need 15 fans for that building, and we just bring a three fan system out and do a pretest to see what kind of pressure we're able to achieve. We can, from that information, we can make some approximations and guess, you know, if we can get it up to 20 or 15, we can extrapolate and get an idea how many fans we need. And if we only need to bring nine fans instead of 15, that's a huge difference in the amount of manpower and time it's going to take to test that building. So the first test method is E779, and this is the we're used to in the software looking at a logarithmic scale format. So instead of seeing that curve, the building leakage curve, even though this is on a straight line, it's often referred to as a building leakage curve for that reason. So we can see, you know, that the difference, because this is a logarithmic scale in both directions, the difference between 4 and 5 here, and the difference between 70 and 80 are about the same. You know, it's a logarithmic scale instead of on a curve. But that there's a big advantage to looking at this at the test this way, because we can see using the software, we can see during the test if our points are falling on a line. If they're not falling on a line, then we can tell if a door blew open, for example. We've been at tests where that's happened. During the test, the door blows open, either pressurization or depressurization, depending on which way the door swings, and we can see that in our results right away, and not have to wait till the end of the test to have to repeat the test. We can just pause the test and find where that problem was and solve it during the test. So as I mentioned, this is our flow formula where C is the airflow and leaks through the building. So we've got our Q here is the CFM airflow is equal to a coefficient, and our C is the airflow at 1 pascal. So that's our coefficient times a change in pressure times the induced pressure we're using, and that's raised to an n power. So that's our coefficient. And theoretically, that coefficient needs to be between 0.5 and 1. And that's in the standards, it says that in E779 that your exponent, in order for this to be a real test, needs to be between 0.5 and 1. So, airflow at any pressure can be calculated using the C and the N. So that's one big advantage of being of doing that regression analysis is you're able to calculate flow at any pressure. Once you have that C and that N, you can plug it into that formula and calculate the flow at another pressure. In this example, we're using that same graph that I just showed. So our C is 2400, so it takes 2400 CFM to get that building to 1 pascal, and we've got an exponent of 0.6, so that's between 0.5 and 1. We know that's a valid one. Just generally speaking, our exponents are going to be between 0.6 and 0.55 and 0.7 is where most of them will lie. So that's our exponent. So if we plug those numbers into a formula, we can figure out our airflow at 5 pascals. We take our C times our pressure, 5 pascals, raised to the N, raised to our exponent. In this case, equals 6,390 CFM. So this again shows us that 1 pascal is 2,400, 5 pascals is 6,400. So it's definitely not linear. It's it follows that scale of that graph of an exponent with an exponent involved. The second basic test method is E1827, which is a repeated single point test. So you'll do a baseline, bring it up to a certain pressure, take another baseline, and then you'll start that over again. Then you'll take a baseline, bring it up to a certain pressure, take another baseline. So each data point needs a pre and a post baseline, and you keep repeating that. So that, if what you want to know is the pressure at 75, it's going to be most efficient to induce that 75 pascals and take that measurement multiple times. And you'll get your results, repeatability testing we did shows better repeatability if you're testing continually, doing a repeated point at that pressure rather than doing a multi-point test, repeating a multi-point test a number of times. So E1827 has its advantages that way. You won't be able to calculate pressures. You won't have that regression analysis and that CNN to calculate flows at lower pressures. But if you're not interested in that, this might be the most efficient way to do a test. So normalizing for the size of the building is typically done either using the volume of the building or the square footage of the surface area, the envelope area. And more standards are moving towards the CFM per square foot of envelope area. And for obvious reasons, the building leaks at its surface area, not its volume. So it makes more sense to compare them. And there's not a good correlation, especially when you get into bigger, odd-shaped buildings. There's not a good correlation between air changes per hour and CFM per square foot of surface area. So it's best to, because the leakage is on the envelope area, to use that metric. So we talked about test standards. E779 is the one that's most commonly referred to. That requires taking data at six different data points between 10 and 60, approximately evenly spaced, and both pressurization and depressurization. So you need to test it both ways and average those results. ASTM E1827 is an airtightness using an orifice blower door, which is what we typically think of for measuring building tightness, and that's a repeated single point test, or there's also a repeated two point test where you're measuring at 10 pascals and 50 pascals, and then you do some analysis based on those two data points, but they're both repeated tests, either single point or two point. The CSGB is a standard that came out in the 80s and hasn't been changed since it first came out. This is a method that's always been in our Tektite software since Tektite came out, and that's an 8-point test between 15 and 50 pascals every 5 pascals. U.S. Army Corps of Engineer came out with a protocol. It's based on E779, but makes some changes. They require 10 data points instead of 6. It's between 25 and 75, not 10 and 60. The reporting pressure for that is 75 pascals. And they made some other changes to it to make it so you could test under a lot more weather conditions. ASTM E779 has restrictions based on what your baseline would be. So based on indoor and outdoor temperature and height of the building, they restrict what days you can test, where the Army Corps is basically says your lowest reading you take a pressure at needs to be three times what your baseline is. So you may end up starting at a much higher pressure to do the test, but at least, if you're out there, you've got all your equipment set up, you're ready to do the test, the weather conditions aren't going to stop you in most cases. You don't want to try to test during a hurricane. You have to, be within reason, but allow you to test on more days. The Air Barrier Association of America is currently working on a standard that's going to be an ANSI standard. And this will be the most comprehensive standard on how to set up a building for the test. The Army Corps goes into a lot of details, but the Air Barrier Association will go into even more details, and it'll be an ANSI standard. So hopefully, you know, we're thinking long term that this will be another accepted standard that could maybe be used in code compliance or other compliance testing. TechLog 3 is used for analysis. It's great where you're able to see everything on a graph, where your pressures are, and you're able to check the results after you get a few data points in there to make sure that they're all falling on a line. And then it'll do all of the analysis for you to calculate the CNN and the error and bias and all those things that are required for reporting in when you're following standards. And also will generate a report that includes all of the information that you need for the Army Corps standard. So TechLog 3 is great for doing that analysis. And so this is showing you the pressurization and depressurization on a logarithmic chart after both tests are done. And you can choose either test 1, test 2, or the combined test. You can change your reporting pressure to 50 or 75, whatever your reporting pressure is, and it'll display the flow based on that. And you're going to enter in the surface area of the building, so then it'll calculate. If you enter that in, it'll calculate the CFM per square foot of surface area, and then the confidence intervals and all that other information, correlation coefficient that you need to determine if you've got a good test. And now we'll move to chapter 2, planning a blower door test. There are certainly a lot of preparations involved in performing a blower door test. And we'll talk about the building and equipment setup, the data collection and analysis. There's a lot of information we're going to need to gather, and we need to make sure we get all the information gathered for analysis and make sure that that's done before we leave, before we break down and return the building to operational status. So preparations is going to include reviewing the test specs and drawings to make sure we understand everything that's required. We'll need to identify the test enclosure boundaries. That's certainly important. And we can't necessarily do that by ourselves. We're going to need help from people involved in the building, construction and design. We'll need to identify parties. There's a lot of people that are involved in leading up to test day and people that need to be there on test day, getting all our questions answered ahead of time and then being there to help us during construction to identify things. If the building is occupied or unoccupied, it certainly makes a difference in how we perform the test and how we prepare for a test. Even though we think we have an unoccupied building, it's rare that you do, especially if you're testing new construction and it's towards the end of construction. You're almost never in a building that's unoccupied. We'll talk about what's involved in selecting a date and calculating the number of test fans needed. So we're going to review the specs and the drawings to prepare for the test. What's the purpose of the test? That's certainly important. What test method are we going to use? Is there an air tightness target that we're shooting for? How will the building be prepared? To what extent are we going to seal the intentional openings, the mechanical openings in the building? That's certainly important to know ahead of time, because that can be as time consuming as setting up and performing the tests. So both sealing those intentional openings and unsealing them, returning it to pre-test conditions. Identification of the test envelope. We mentioned that before, but it's critical that we get that spelled out. And then once we have identified it, we need to calculate the volume or the area to be used in our calculation. And how do we determine if the test passes? That needs to be spelled out ahead of time. You don't go out to the on test day without the volume or the square footage that's included in the results determined. That needs to be determined before test day. And it needs to be clear how to determine if the test passes. So if the target is 0.25 and your test results show 0.24 plus or minus 0.02, that means our test results are somewhere between 0.22 and 0.26. Does that pass or not? That it's spelled out clearly in the Army Corps how to determine if it passes or not. So you need to know ahead of time whether a test passes or not. What determines if it passes or not? You don't want to be in a situation where you don't know if it passes or not. That's not a good position to be in. And certainly needs to be defined ahead of time before test day what happens if the building fails. If you're going to charge for a retest, how much that's going to be, and all of that needs to be spelled out ahead of time. So make sure, you know, all of this, what this is coming down to is make sure that expectations are clear. What's your responsibility? What are you going to need to make sure everything is in place so you can perform this test? And certainly note any requirements that need follow-up as you're going through this process, and keep checking that list and make sure that you're getting everything you need before test day comes. So identifying the test enclosure boundaries is certainly easier if you can make up a SketchUp model of the building. If you're familiar with SketchUp, if you do this to scale, it can do all of the boundary surface area calculations for you. It can help you with that. So, you know, if you have a plan view, a footprint of the building, you can put that into SketchUp and then just pull up each section to the height it needs to be, and that certainly can make this process more accurate, and you won't miss any of the areas. And in complex buildings, it would be worth the time of setting this up in SketchUp or having somebody set it up in SketchUp so the square footage can be calculated. And ideally, this would be done by the architect, right? The architect should have identified where the test boundaries are, and they've got the plans. So it's certainly to your advantage for them to do the calculation. It's not a bad idea to take, you know, if it takes an hour to verify what their calculations are, or 2 hours, you know, it'd certainly be worth doing that to make sure that that it's a reasonable number, that it's within, you know, 10 or 15%, 20% even, to make sure we're in the ballpark with that number, because that plays a big part in determining a pass-fail is what's that test enclosure, test envelope area. And those terms, I know they're used interchangeably, enclosure or envelope. Most of the time we'll use envelope because that's a terminology that's used in the Army Corps standard and in E-779. So, who are the parties that need to be involved? The owner, certainly, and during construction, the builder is the owner. So the builder is probably the person you have the contract with, because they're the owner until they turn over the keys to who's ultimately going to be the owner of the building. The building management, who's managing that, and who is their staff during construction that can help you with locating and shutting off the HVAC or locating the breakers in case you trip a breaker during the test, all of those kinds of things. Security. There, in most buildings, there'll be areas of the buildings, even during construction, as it ends, gets towards the end of construction, if they've got computer systems set up, you probably won't have access to those spaces. So there's certain areas that whether there's property or something in there that needs to be protected, and you won't have access. That certainly needs to be identified ahead of time. Health and safety issues. A good example is a metal ladder. If you show up with a metal ladder on an Army Corps site, they won't let you on the site because of the issue with electricity and metal. So you need to know that ahead of time. The fan testing and the find the holes team, if that's part of your contract, is to do the infrared and use other processes to find the holes. If that's your responsibility, then you need to get those teams in place. The HVAC control person, certainly. If you're responsible for sealing all the intentional HVAC penetrations, you need to know where all of those are. And you need somebody on site to help you identify those and help you shut all those down on test day. And also, as always, you need to keep your eyes and ears open, because you're not working with an as-built drawing. You're built with a design drawing, and there may be some things that weren't on the plan that you'll run across. And this HVAC control person should know what those things are too, and can point those out. Witnesses, if you're doing an Army Corps test, there's typically an Army Corps witness, maybe more than one. The owner, the future owner, and the contractor may have people present, especially if there were contentious things that happened during construction. There may be people there from both the builder and the future building owner. And fix the holes crew. Or if this is a contractor you're working with for the first time, and they haven't given you much access to the building during construction to verify that, or you're not getting paid to verify that the details are going to be done right, you'll probably want to line up a fix a hole crew to be there. So when you complete the test, are you gonna, if time allows, are they going to try to fix the holes before you break down, or are they going to be there while the equipment is still on the site and they'll do work, or they'll do the repairs for a half a day, and then you'll test it again. All those details need to be thought out ahead of time before test day. Selecting a date. If it's an occupied building, you're certainly going to want to do it on weekends or holidays. We were involved helping Center for Energy and Environment. They got a grant to test a number of public buildings in Minnesota, and we helped them on about a dozen of those tests. And they're mostly schools and libraries. So schools was easy. We tested them during the summer when there's still people in the building, doing maintenance and repairs during the summer, but certainly a lot fewer than if the building was being used. Or on with library buildings, it ends up being holidays typically, or nights when you end up doing the testing. So selecting a date and a time. And during the test, you're going to need access, right? To all the rooms. Some of them for security reasons you want to have access to, but you'll need access to the mechanical rooms, locations where HVAC penetrations will need to be masked, which is typically attic access and mechanical rooms, the HVAC controls contractor, and all these need to be figured out in order to select the date. So planning for the building setup, sometimes weather is an issue. You don't want to be trying to do ceiling on the exterior in inclement conditions. If it's pouring rain or cold and windy, you want to make sure, and as the test date gets near, to set a date when weather is going to be manageable. You'll need to, doors and windows are a consideration. Are they in? Are they all in? What doors will be best to have access for doing the blower? You don't, if people are going to be coming in and out during the test, you want to stay away from those doors where that's likely to happen. And get away from where your command center is. HVAC equipment needs to be turned off during the test. It's part of the planning. Where are the HVAC penetrations? What materials and equipment are you going to need to seal these up and to do the test? A lot of miscellaneous tools and supplies. You want to make a list of the basic information that is going to be needed, that you're going to need to gather. Any security issues, official witnesses, and personnel provided by the client. You're going to. So when it comes to building setup date, you're going to want to make sure all of these things are in line. So planning the equipment setup, how much air do we need? We're going to need, in order to calculate that, we're going to need to know if the standard is based on surface area. We're going to need to know the surface area. If it's based on volume, we're going to need to know the volume. And then once we have that information, we know what the tightness standard is. We know what the metric, the volume, or the surface area is. Then we can calculate how many test bands we need. So once we figure out how many bands we need, we need to figure out how many frames and one and two and three hole panels for that setup. And a lot of additional things that go along with the test equipment, the extra tubing to monitor interior pressures, to make sure we have single zone conditions, and running exterior tubing to each side, towards the center of each side of the building. Extension cords to each fan needs its own circuit, so we need lots of extension cords, and sometimes 25 feet will do it, and other times you'll need 100 feet or more. So make sure you have enough extension cords. You'll need a watt meter to determine if fans are on separate circuits, and we'll talk about that a little later. Ladders, and if it's an Army Corps job, it'll need to be fiberglass. Non-metal ladders, carts to move equipment around, hand tools. Sometimes you'll need to deal with door closers, and sometimes you may disconnect the door closers, otherwise you might plug the leak above the frame. We'll show you a little bit about some ideas on how to do that. Metal tubing, if we're measuring pressures to the outside, Oftentimes that'll mean closing the door on a tube, so you want some metal tubing to breach that area under the door to so you won't pinch a hose. Extra batteries, certainly. You want to bring a supply of those and make sure all your DG700s have adequate battery strength before you start. Indoor wedges. If you've got a big building with lots and lots of interior doors, you need to bring gunny sacks full of door wedges to prop open all those doors. So that's all part of the planning process. And then, you know, whatever you're going to need to make the connection between the blower door fan systems and the computer. There'll be hardware and cabling involved, or else Wi-Fi connections and with routers and Wi-Fi links. You want to inspect the geometry of the building for interior bottlenecks. That's part of the planning on setting up a blower door, and we'll talk about that in a little more detail. And planning the blower door locations to account for those bottlenecks. Locating the areas where we want to measure those interzonal pressures to document the uniform pressure distribution in the building. And we'll need a varied list of temporary sealing materials to seal the mechanical openings, intentional openings in the building as needed, and certainly spares. spares of everything to make sure everything goes smooth on test day. And, you know, that becomes more important for certain things. You know, most of the time there's going to be a hardware store or a lumber yard close by or maybe a office supply place where you can pick up some spare parts. But the things that you can't access, you know, a couple extra blower door controllers or even a extra blower door fan, or, you know, things that you won't likely be able to find within close proximity, you want to make sure you have some spares available. Part of the plan is typically on a blueprint, mark out where your fans are going to be. And where your outside references are going to be, and where your interior pressure measurements are going to be. Get all that prepared and make notes on that plan. And then certainly health and safety. Typically, when you go on an Army Corps job site, a military site, you have to get through a security. You have to... sometimes there's a badge that'll be required even to get onto the Army base. And before you can start testing, they may require that you have gone through certain OSHA training. And they'll probably have a safety meeting where you sit down with a safety officer for the construction company. With the job site soup and a safety person and go through a slideshow and they'll make sure that you have goggles and safety vests and jeans and work boots. You know, you're not going to get on these job sites with tennis shoes and shorts. Steel toe boots are required sometimes, and certainly you won't see something like this where you've got a metal ladder in a pool and you're working on some electrical with a drilling a hole with a cord stretched across the pool, or you know, there's just some silly things you'll see on job sites that won't be allowed on these sites. If you're working close to the edge of a roof, you're going to need to tie yourself off and those kind of things you'll need to take into consideration when you're on these types of jobs. Well, thanks for attending our webinar today. And if you'd like to stick around, we'll take some time now to answer questions. And we'd appreciate any feedback you can give us also on what you'd like to see in future webinars. So I'm going to review some of these questions coming in that have come in, and we'll start going over those.
Well, thanks for attending this first part of our two-part series, and this will be available to download. There'll be a link to it on our website. It'll be on our YouTube site. So if you want to view this, or if you want others in your company or other people you know about to have access and be able to view it, go ahead and let them know about that link on our website that goes to our YouTube site. So some of the questions we had during the webinar. One was, is it necessary to use four outdoor references instead of one on a leeward side? It is if you're using only one outside reference. It is best to put it close to the building, towards the center of the building, on the leeward side. That's where you'll get the most stable pressure. It is common for big building testing, though, to measure it on the four sides of the building. And that's recommended in E779. They have some diagrams in there about where to place it, and it's much as what we're recommending. And the TechLog software will average however many pressures you have labeled as envelope pressures in the software. It'll average all of those. There's a question about our recommendation. You know, they're wondering if larger tubes would be helpful if you were running more than 100 feet, and that would be an option. We've never done that. It is pretty rare that you're going to need more than 100 feet of tubing. But if you do, for example, if you're measuring from the top of a building to the bottom, you could put the DG700 in one of the middle floors and run 100 feet up and 100 feet down. So you can run pretty far in a building with 100 feet of tubing. And where it gets affected the most is when you have long lengths of tubing outside. It's going to be more of an issue than long lengths of tubing inside. Another question was what preferred tubing colors would we recommend? And the best ones would be clear tubing or white tubing would be less affected, the least affected by the sun, or whatever, you know, lighter colors you have. The darker the color, the more it would be affected by the sun. Let's see, we've got a couple more questions coming in here. Pressurization instead of depressurization in older buildings because of potential lead and asbestos. That is certainly true in any case where there are environmental hazards in the building. You'll have to take into consideration what approach is going to be best for doing the test. The Army Corps standard and E779 standard require both depressurization and pressurization. So E779, you need at least 6 data points in each direction, so 12 data points total. Army Corps testing, 10 data points positive, 10 negative. So it does, if you're following one of those standards, if that's the specs you're given, is to follow one of those standards, you'll need to get it clarified if you're only going to do it in one direction or the other before testing. So everything's clear, the expectations are clear, and what's possible and safe will need to be clear right from the outset. Resources regarding who to market to for these services. Generally speaking, most of this testing is taking place on either through the Army Corps of Engineers, so you could contact them. I'm not sure exactly who you would contact in your area, but I'm sure getting on the website and sending some emails would be a good place to start. So they are testing all new military buildings now, and they're it's my understanding they're starting to renovate existing buildings also to improve efficiency. The government GSA, Government Services Association, is starting to do testing, so you might check in your area to see if the state or local county or city governments are requiring testing on government buildings. That's becoming more common than it has in the past. Some states, Washington comes to mind, and Washington State adopted a code where all the buildings taller than five stories need to have a blow door test. It's my understanding that they're only really being enforced in the Seattle area, but there's more demand for testing in those kind of buildings. I know South Face down in the Atlanta area, it may have extended to some states beyond Georgia. They have a small commercial program where you can get rebates and such, and help with testing expenses, I think, on testing small commercial buildings. So you might check with South Face down in that area to find out availability of testing. And other places, just, they may be looking for somebody who can do some diagnostic testing where there's problems associated with buildings. Hospitals have been, we've been getting more calls about hospital buildings where they've got rooms that are either have somebody who's got an infectious disease or somebody who has immune deficiencies, so they have to run either positive or negative pressure in those spaces, and they want those spaces to be tight, and they want to know how many CFM it's going to take to pressurize it by a certain amount, and they're even starting to record pressures in those spaces to make sure that they're maintaining the right pressure. So hospitals is another source. We've gotten calls from places like maybe they're storing some chemicals out in a warehouse and there's an office space attached to that building, and they don't want odors from that warehouse getting in the building, so they want to make a good air barrier between those two spaces and keep the office space pressurized so there's not air from the warehouse getting into the house. So that it takes a combination of getting the space tight, knowing how much air imbalance it's going to take to keep a certain space pressurized and with respect to the warehouse. So those are just a few list of a few ideas where this type of work and diagnostics on commercial buildings are where it's headed. All right, looks like we pretty much wrapped up the questions that are coming up. If I didn't get your question, I will respond to those by email. Feel free to email or call me if any questions come up or you have any questions about this testing. And we do get people who have gotten some funny results on TechLab 3 tests on larger buildings, and they'll send me copies of the TechLab test, and we'll look it over and see if we can't troubleshoot some of the issues that have happened. Some common errors have to do with tubing connections and not connecting the tubing correctly under pressurization, and having to go back and try to figure out what the real numbers were after the fact. Some of those kinds of things. So we're always available to answer questions, or phones are answered for tech support between 8 a.m. and 4 p.m. Central Time. So call and email, and we'll try to answer them as best we can. Thank you again.